The Lord. Good morning, everyone. All right. Praise God. Let's stand together. Will you say a word of prayer with me as we open our Sunday morning service with excitement, with anticipation? Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this Sunday that you've given to us. Lord, we expect some exciting things happening this morning. God, you're really going to move, Lord, and we're going to ask for your presence to fill this place right now. We anticipate that your power is going to fall upon us this morning as, Lord, we focus on healing this morning, Lord God. So, Lord, we just draw from heaven, Lord, your healing power. And, Lord, we are going to be excited about all the healings you've done in the past, God. We're going to build upon that faith, Lord Jesus, that, Lord, you've healed so many people in the past, Lord. And, Lord, we're going to believe that you're going to do something special this morning. So we thank you, Lord. We give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Will you please turn around and greet one another this morning and say good morning. Welcome. And if you see somebody by themselves, would you please greet them? Good morning. Good to see all of you in the house of the Lord. And would you also bring your Bibles and your notebooks? And if you want, would you please move in the center of the aisle right here, the center section. This is the main section. So if you want to just bring your stuff to the main section and leave the sides for some of those who come in a little bit later, that would be awesome. So if you want to do that, that'd be great. All right, you want to center focus right here where God's going to just move in a mighty way and you have the center seat. That would be awesome too, all right? Praise God, praise God. Praise God, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to read to you from Psalm 92. From the New Living Translation, it says this: It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to the Most High. It is good to proclaim your unfailing love in the morning, your faithfulness in the evening, accompanied by a guitar, drums, bass, and keyboard. Okay, I added that on my own, all right? It sings a 10-string instrument, a harp, and the melody. Here's, check this out. It says, you thrill me, Lord, with all you have done for me. I sing for joy because of what you have done. Amen. Does that sound good? We're going to sing for joy for what he has done this morning for us. Praise God. Hallelujah. This morning is our healing service this morning. We're going to sing about how God is so good. So sing with me this morning.
I can do anything, I can do all things, 'cause it's you who gives me strength. Nothing is impossible, through you blind eyes are open, strongholds are broken, I'm living by faith.
This morning, hallelujah.
Let's speak to it. Speak to every limitation. Victory is my declaration. The same power that raised you from the grave is in me, so I can live.
To us. That's why we're praising and worshiping him, because he's such a good God. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
good God you are, Lord Jesus. Lord, that's why we sing, Lord God, because you're such an amazing God. Hallelujah. Lord, your name is beautiful, it's wonderful, and it's powerful, Lord Jesus. Thank you for that, Lord Jesus.
Yours is the name of
can stand against. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
Jesus, your name is who we praise, Lord, who we worship, God. We lift up the name of Jesus. Lord, you reign, oh God, hallelujah. The name of Jesus, hallelujah. It's all in your name, God, hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus. Your name, oh God, hallelujah. It's your name, oh Lord Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Praise your Lord Jesus, hallelujah. The name of Jesus, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Where your name is, Lord, there's power, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, Lord. Fear doesn't live here no more. Fear doesn't live here no more. Your name was spoken. Your name brought healing to me.
Hallelujah. It's the name of Jesus that brings healing.
Shame doesn't live here no more.
Declare that this morning.
Shame doesn't live here no more. Your name was spoken. Your love brought healing to me. Sin lost all control, I am set free. By your glory and grace, you broke every chain, I am set free.
Sing your name, Lord.
Lord, we are set free because of you. And Father, because of you, there is freedom, Lord. There is healing, Lord. There is deliverance, God. There's restoration, Lord. Those things the devil has taken, Lord, we get it all back and double of what he took. Because, Lord, you are God. You are Lord. Father, you love us so much, Lord. The patience, the kindness, the joy that you bestow on us, Lord, because your love is that great, Lord. So, Father, thank you, Lord, this morning that we have freedom, Lord. Thank you, Father, we can stand before you set free and know, Lord, that we are delivered because of the blood of the Lamb, knowing that we can receive healing because of you, Lord, and knowing, Lord, that we are set free. The devil can never hold us again, Lord, to any of those chains, Father, our past and Lord. Father, our hurts don't hold us, Lord, because we are indeed set free because of you, Lord. Father, I just pray you do something pretty amazing this morning, Lord. Father, there are people here who've been bound in sickness, Lord, who feel like death, Lord. Father, there's people here who've been bound by depression and loneliness and isolation, Lord. But God, Father, you deliver all these things because you are God, Lord. So I ask for your anointing to cover the rest of this service, Lord. I pray that your anointing will cover the preaching of the word through Pastor Terry, Lord. The healing service, Lord, that's going to happen, Lord. Father God, and the miracles that we're going to see, we're going to be a witness of, because we know that you are in the deliverance, the healing, the restoration business, Lord. And so we love you so much, Lord. We give you praise. Take this service, and Lord, and may you be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen.
God is good, and all the time. Awesome. At this time, we just want to welcome some friends in the house, and with that is friends. Welcome time. Praise God. I'd like to introduce you to Alvin as a friend of Elizabeth. We'd like to welcome Alvin in the house, right over there. Praise God. I'd also like to welcome Rose. She's actually she's done mission works in Philippines and brought by Caroline, our friend Caroline. And there's Rose right over there. Praise God. Good to see Teen Challenge in the house. See a lot of new faces over there. Please say hi to them later. Get together. Okay, welcome all. Every nation, every tribe, every tongue. Amen. Well, we're going to have an awesome service today. You guys ready? I'll give us friend a nice warm aloha on three. One, two, three. Aloha! Give him another hand.
All right, so we're going to continue our worship of Jesus with more than a song, with our tithes and our offering. If you need an envelope, you could raise your hand, and our ushers would be more than happy to give you guys an envelope. If you're writing a check, please make it out to Calvary Assembly of God. You know, the appropriate response to a blessing is thank you. Can someone say thank you? The Bible has this story where Jesus, he's kind of going to this one city, and there are these 10 guys that were infected with a disease called leprosy. And so they were crying out, Jesus, have mercy on me. And so Jesus tells them, you know what? Go and show yourselves to the priests. And so as they were going, the Bible says that they were healed. And this is what happens in that story. And I'm just going to read a verse. It says, they went, and while on their way, they became clean. One of them, when he realized that he was healed, turned around and came back shouting his gratitude, glorifying God. He kneeled at Jesus' feet so grateful. He couldn't thank him enough. And he was a Samaritan. And Jesus' response to him was, were not 10 healed? Where are the other 9? The appropriate response to a blessing is thank you. Can someone say thank you? Thank you. In Wailua and Haliva, North Shore, I've had the privilege of I've been visiting and praying for a lot of Filipinos actually in the North Shore area. And especially with the Catholic Filipinos, I noticed they have like this tradition where after I pray for them, they try to offer me money. And so every time I'm like, no. And they're like, oh, you sure? I'm like, yeah, don't worry, you know, give it to God at church and all that. But this past Tuesday, I went to this one house, and one of the persons that I'm discipling, he introduced me to his auntie. She suffered from a stroke, and so I was at her house with her husband, and we were just talking, and I was praying for her, and after the prayer, she's like, oh, Father, where are you from? I'm like, oh, you can just call me Israel, not a father. And I said, oh, I'm from the Kamiki area. She's like, wow, thank you so much for coming here. And she said something in Filipino to her husband, and I knew what he was going for. The husband got up, went to the room, and I knew they're going to get money, so I turned to my friend who's also an interpreter for me, because she doesn't really speak any English. I tell him, hey, tell her I don't need any money. I didn't come here for money. And so my friend, he starts speaking Filipino. I won't even try, but he's speaking Filipino to her. And he's like, no, he didn't. You know, Pastor didn't come here for money. He just came here to bless you. And she looked him in the eye and said, no, I need to give something to God. And you can see that there's such appreciation for having just taken time to sit with her and pray with her. And the appropriate response was a thank you. And that's what she wanted to do. She didn't just want to give money. She wanted to say thank you. And it was with more than just words. You know, Jesus is looking for us to say thank you to him. He sacrificed his life for us. He gave 100%. And so we're just saying thank you by paying our 10% in tithes. and giving up our offering. So let's have the right attitude of appreciation. Father God, we just want to thank you, Lord, that we can continue worshiping you, Lord, with more than a song, with more than just words from our lips. We can give to you, Father God, of what you have given to us, Lord. We pay our 10% with appreciation. We thank you, God, for saving us, for dying on the cross for our sins, for purchasing healing for all of us, God. So we want to say thank you, God, with appreciation and gratitude, Lord. We glorify your name. We recognize that you are Almighty God. And with that, we ask that you bless the offering and all those that are giving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Nursery is now dismissed.
Aloha, and welcome to Calvary Assembly of God. We're so glad you're here today. If this is your first time here at Calvary, we'd love for you to fill out a connections card so that we could get to know you a bit. When you're done, please return it to one of our ushers. Here you go, Julio.
Thank you, Crystal.
Well, there's a lot going on here at Calvary, so here are a few of the things that are coming up.
This Friday is the third Friday of the month, and that means we'll be having our monthly food for families. Registration is from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m., and we distribute the boxes of food at 3 p.m. We have lunch for volunteers at around noon and start packing the boxes at 1 p.m. There's also a special evangelistic service at 2 p.m. Come out this Friday. Be blessed and be a blessing.
Hey, Calvary Assembly. 60th anniversary is coming up soon. This year, we're celebrating Calvary's 60th birthday with 3 days of awesomeness in December. Starting Friday, December 9th, we'll be having a family-style gathering at church with special VIPs. On Saturday, December 10th, we're having an awesome lunch buffet at Halekoa Hotel. Reserve your spot now with Janetta and Juliana. We'll be having delicious food, fun specials, and lots of cool memories. We are blessed to have the Honorable Duke Iona to speak at our luncheon. It will be an exciting luncheon, so register now. On Sunday, December 11th, we'll be looking forward to celebrating Calvary in the next upcoming years. We are blessed to have former District Superintendent of the Hawaii Assemblies of God, Pastor George Nagato, to inspire us. Everyone is welcome to come join us for these 3 days of celebration. See you all there. Woo!
Hey, Calvary. Coming up on November 20th, we have the biggest Friend Day of the year. It will be our Thanksgiving Friend Day with a special Thanksgiving turkey lunch happening right after service on November 20th. So be sure to invite all of your friends, family members, and everyone on this planet called Earth. And in preparation for that, we are also looking for your prayer triplets. So the people that you want to invite out, we will be praying for name by name every day of every week leading up to November 20th. So please submit your prayer triplets to Crystal. See you there.
Well, those are this week's announcements. Details for all those events, our contact information, and more can be found in today's bulletin. We hope you enjoy the service, and God bless.
Praise the Lord. It's Mission Sunday, Friend Day. Woo! All right, this is our second to the last Mission Sunday. And, you know, our Mission Sundays, you know, we are reminded as a church that we are to, you know, lift up our eyes and see the harvest, you know, seeing others, how we can bless others, how we can be a witness to others, others in our community, others in our nation, others in ends of the earth. And that's what our Mission Sunday is all about. So I'm going to ask the ushers to come on up. And this is the second to the last time that we're going to be officially collecting pledges for 2016. So if you haven't have a chance to fulfill all of your pledges, to make sure you do that. And if you're not sure about how much you gave, you can see either Sister Irene, okay, or one of our missions treasurers for that, okay? Or you can see myself, and we can find that out for you, okay? So praise God. Let's just pray for the offering at this time. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, for missions and your heartbeat, Lord, for those who don't know you, Lord. And, you know, we know that your heart is for those who still don't know you, Lord, that you're not willing that any perish, Lord, that all will come to repentance, Lord. And we just thank you, Lord, that we have a chance to give to missions. And we just thank you, Lord, for many of my brothers and sisters who've been giving faithfully, sacrificially, Lord, unto you. And may you continue to bless them, Lord, and use this offering that it will go forth, these pledges, it will go forth to bless our missionaries and missions projects all around the our island here in Hawaii, also in our nation, also to the ends of the earth, Lord, the different countries that we are supporting as well. We just praise you and thank you once again. May you just multiply this. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Praise God once again. You know, you guys have been really, I know, have been faithful, sacrificial, and, you know, living simply so others may simply live. So praise God for you guys. Okay, so 2 more months of 2016 pledges. And if you still want to make, you haven't made your 2017 pledges, you can come and see me. There's pledge cards in the back, and you can submit it to me, okay, for 2017. Okay, we don't want to leave you out. Praise God, we have a missions update this month. And this month, if you look in your bulletins, we are featuring James Kobo from Every Nation Japan. You know, praise God that James, you know, this actually it's today, you know, 13th to the 18th. He'll be bringing a team, okay, of Japanese nationals. And they're heading to Kumamoto. And this is the place where the earthquake, yeah, at 7.0 magnitude struck on April 16, 2016. So this is the second time they're bringing a team there. They were there in June, and they're back again. And please pray that, you know, many are affected. If you can see the pictures there, I mean, the devastation is pretty devastating there, as you look to see that. And they want us to ask us to pray for opportunities to minister the gospel, because, you know, the people in Kumamoto needs Christ, okay, especially in this time of crisis. So please pray for opportunities to minister the gospel. Also pray that all the team members encounter Jesus outside the church as they become his hands and feet. Also pray for safety, knowing that, you know, there's a lot of devastation there, yeah? So a lot of places are, I'm sure, unsafe. Also pray for James's Japanese. You know, his Japanese is not that great, so pray that God will quicken his tongue in the Japanese tongue, okay? So please pray for them, okay? James Kobo and his team, and again, they're there this whole week, okay? So, you know, this is what your mission dollars are. We're supporting, okay? These are disaster relief efforts from them, and not only just relief efforts, but they're sharing the gospel, you know, of Jesus Christ to those who especially need it at this time, you know, devastation. So please pray for them. And also some announcements too. We'll be having our missions up close and personal. Missions orientation in February 11th. So those who are interested in going to a mission trip next year, you know, we'll be going to China, San Francisco, Brazil, and Austria. Okay, so on February 11th, on a Saturday, from 9 a.m. to 11:30 a.m., you know, we'll be having our orientation time. Okay, up close and personal missions. If you're interested in going in any of these trips, please make sure you come. Okay, to this up close and personal with missions. Okay. And, you know, we praise God. This year, our theme, you know, for our missions, of course, it's anointed to go. And our theme for the missions conference was relentless in missions, being relentless. And do you know that also that our theme for the Assemblies of God War missions is any place, any price. And that kind of goes hand in hand because, you know, that speaks about relentlessness, right? You know, that I'll go no matter any place, okay, or at any price. I'll still go. When God calls me, I will go. Okay? And here's a video from the Assemblies of God speaking about this theme about any place, any price. Okay, so check this out.
Silent. Wherever you send us, we will declare your name. No turning back, there is no time. only your love still can shine. You have given us your spirit. Now we will go for you into the night.
So exciting to partner with God in doing missions, really. That he's not the only ones doing all the saving, but we can be a part of that. You know, of course, we believe in a three-pronged approach to missions. The praying, which we do all the time, praying for the missions activities all around us, for the giving, and that's why we do faith promises in this church, and for the going, because many of us have gone on missions trips, and there's going to be four awesome ones next year. And of course, there's always the long term. If you want to go for a year or more, you can speak to us about joining our Brazil team. So it's really exciting having purpose in your life rather than just living each day for really nothing, you know, but to live for others. It's so exciting. So I'm excited. Next week, just to underscore, is our Friend Day of the Year. Okay, and I mean that because we're putting everything into this. We're gonna have tents out in the front. In fact, there should have been. You can pick up where you can park. Did you get that in your bulletin? I didn't get one in mine. Did you guys have that? It's on there. Okay, great. Okay, it's on the back. Okay. Oh, maybe I do have it. Oh, I thought it was. Yeah, on the back. No, I don't have on mine. Okay. Well, all right. Give me yours. I don't have one mine. Okay, so on the give thanks, on the back, there's where you can park. Okay, I guess there's some of these. Does everybody have this? Where you can park, okay? Because we're basically closing off the parking lot. Thank you, Pastor Israel. We're closing off the parking lot except for the handicapped people, okay? Because we want to expand this area to really have a big, we're believing, for a lot of people coming out. We're going to be serving a free turkey dinner with the stuffings and all that stuff, okay? So we encourage you to bring out your unchurched friends, okay? This is it, okay? I think every friend likes to eat, right? Is there anybody who have friends that don't like to eat? Okay, so that falls in that category, and it's free, okay? But they can't just come for the lunch. They have to come for the service, which starts at 10:30, and there's going to be a bunch of specials, good message, all of that. Okay, it's going to be a great morning, and really, we're spending a lot of money on this because we want to believe that God's going to touch the hearts of people who come out here. So this is the event for your unchurched friends. Also, if you'd like us to pray for them as well, too, please submit names. We call them prayer triplets. You can submit three people, you know, more if you want to Crystal, and we will make sure that even this week during our corporate prayer meeting, we will pray by name for those friends so that they will come out here. Because how many of you know that the enemy would love for your friends never hear the gospel, never to hear about God, okay? And so here we work as a team, as a church, so that you don't have to feel the pressure of leading somebody to the Lord. We as a church can do it together, okay? So submit your prayer triplets, invite your unchurched friends, and let's just have a really great time next week. And that's all part of what we do missions-wise. We don't just do missions across the ocean. We do across the street as well, across your cubicle, across the walls of your house, okay? People that you can bring to our friend day. Okay, sounds good? Next week, okay? Let's do it. Next week, that's part of our missions initiatives as well, too. Okay, I'm going to preach a different kind of message on this Mission Sunday. You know, Mission Sunday, normally we preach about missions and how we get challenged in praying, giving, and going. But also, a very vibrant part of missions is also where Jesus said that we're to go out into the world, make disciples, and these signs shall follow them that believe. Okay? That's the healing aspect of missions. Because if you read through the Gospels, if you read through the book of Acts, you see that all the people that did missions, Jesus included, the disciples, that healing was a part of missions. And so it's not like we're doing a separate healing service here and why are we doing it on a Mission Sunday? Because healing is part and parcel of missions, okay? So I'd like you to turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. I'm going to read the one translation that has a word that I just love, okay? Because it really underscores something here. I'm going to read the New Living Translation. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, the New Living Translation. The same Spirit gives great faith to another, and to someone else, the one Spirit gives the gift of healing. Okay? This is part of verses 8 to 10, where in Corinthians, it tells us about the different gifts of the Spirit. There's 9 of them listed here. But the emphasis I just wanted to point out here is it says, the same Spirit gives great faith to another. Great faith. And with that, I have entitled my message this morning, Great Faith. Heavenly Father, as I lay hands upon your words, I ask, Lord, that Lord, great faith will rise up right now. Lord, your word says that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And now as we hear the word of God, Lord, I pray that faith will rise up, Lord. We will have faith, Lord, because we need faith in order for healing to take place. And so, Lord, I ask that your Holy Spirit would just minister in our hearts right now and get us excited, oh Lord, about what you can and will do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. So here we have it. We have a Mission Sunday. Focus on missions, but healing is a part of that. Now, in this passage, there are 9 gifts that I mentioned. One of them, in most translations, says it's the gift of faith. Okay? The gift of faith. Now, in my teaching, I have used the adjective special as an adjective to attach to faith here. Because this kind of faith that's given in verses 8 to 10, this whole passage of the spiritual gifts is not your normal faith. It's a special faith. And that's why I like this translation in the New Living Translation. It actually says great faith. It makes it stand out from your, for example, faith that you would have for salvation. See, over in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, it says that by grace are we saved through faith. Okay, let me explain that. Why does it take faith to get saved? Okay, has anybody seen Jesus face to face yet? Anybody here? I want to find out because I want to get your autograph, okay, if anybody has that. Okay, nobody, right? See, nobody. My hand is actually not up, okay? I have never seen Jesus face to face. I have met pastors who have had visions. One, I remember, was telling me the story where he was lying in bed, and then Jesus sat right next on the bed with him and had a conversation with him. I go, wow, I would love that, okay? But you know, it hasn't happened to me yet. And nor am I praying for that, because one day up in heaven, I will see him face to face anyways. Okay? If that's not his will, because there was a time 2,000 years ago when he did appear face to face. But now in 2016, that doesn't seem to be the common occurrence. Okay? But because none of us have seen Jesus before, and yet most, if not all of us, are Christians or born again, that means that we had to believe in someone we have never met before, right? That takes faith. Because unless you've met somebody, then you can say confidently, with evidence, with maybe an iPhone photo, here I am with Jesus. But nobody can show that on their iPhone, right? Right? And if it was on a Samsung 7, it would explode on you, you know? But never mind. Ooh, bad joke, okay? But none of us can say that. So your faith is what got you saved, because you have to believe in someone whom you have not met. The Bible tells us that the moment that you get saved is when the Lord gives you the faith to believe in him. So that way you become a Christian. He writes your name in a book in heaven called the Lamb's Book of Life. So again, has anybody seen that book before? Okay, it talks about in Revelation, the Lamb's Book of Life. I've not seen it. I've never seen it on a YouTube yet. Nobody has gone to heaven and taped it. Okay? So again, by faith, we have to believe that we are saved, because everyone's name in that book is saved. So to really prove that you're saved, you have to look at the book. Well, none of us have seen it. So again, it takes faith to believe, because you have not seen it yet. You understand? That's the faith for salvation. Now, in 1 Corinthians 12:9, it's not talking about that kind of faith. Okay? It's talking about a special faith. There's something that stands out about this kind of faith, and that's why the New Living Translation adds the adjective great faith. It's to believe in a miracle. Something that you normally could not do just by believing. It takes more than just belief. Okay? You need great faith. Now, we're going to look at a couple stories this morning about this area of great faith. In Matthew chapter 5, verses 5 to 13, I'm going to read to you in the New King James Version, because I think that of all the translations that I looked at like 20 versions here, that this one probably expresses what the original Greek says, because the New Testament was written in Greek. So let me read it here. Verse 5. Now when Jesus had entered Capernaum, a centurion came to him, pleading with him, saying, "Lord, my servant is lying at home paralyzed, dreadfully tormented." And Jesus said to him, "I will come and heal him." The centurion answered and said, "Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof, but only speak a word, and my servant will be healed. For I also am a man under authority, having soldiers under me. And I say to this one, go, and he goes, and to another, come, and he comes, and to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to those who followed, "Assuredly, I say to you, I have not found such great faith." Everybody say that with me. Great faith. "Not even in Israel. And I say to you that many will come from east and west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom will be cast out into outer darkness. There will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Then Jesus said to the centurion, "Go your way, and as you have believed, so let it be done for you," as his servant was healed that same hour. So now we look at this passage here, okay? Jesus had entered into Capernaum, this pre-believer, okay? This guy's not a Christian. He's a Roman centurion, meaning that he has at least 100 soldiers under him. He is a leader. But he has an issue here, because his servant is lying at home paralyzed, and he's in great pain, okay? So he's paralyzed, he's in great pain. He's asking for help. And so the first thing that we notice here is that you must ask Jesus for help. We can't let Satan lie to you that it is God's will that is happening. On Tuesday, I held a special healing seminar for people who have expressed interest in learning more about healing. And I made one statement, and that is that it is God's will to heal always. It is God's will to heal always. In fact, if you turn with me to Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. Now, keep your hands in Matthew, or you can just watch the screen here, okay? In Exodus 15, 26, it says, "If you listen carefully to the Lord your God and do what is right in his eyes, if you pay attention to his commands and keep all his decrees, I will not bring on you any of the diseases I brought on the Egyptians, for I am the Lord who heals you. Okay? The Old Testament was written primarily in Hebrew. There's two Hebrew words that are translated, I am the Lord who heals you. It is Jehovah Rapha, R-A-P-H-A, for those who are taking notes. R-A-P-H-A, Rapha. Jehovah means God, and Rapha means what kind of God he is. He's the God that heals. Okay? And there's many redemptive names of God in the Hebrew, in the Old Testament. You see Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Rapha here, Jehovah Rohi, Jehovah Shammah. There's a whole bunch of Jehovah, okay? This one, Jehovah Rapha, is translated in English accurately, I am the Lord who heals you. Now, God doesn't just give himself a name for the sake of a rhyme or because of some heritage or whatever, okay? In the Bible, and I have preached on this many times, names are very significant. Most of the time, the names that are given denote somebody's character or nature. Okay? That's why, you know, I'm sorry if you know somebody named this name, but Jacob is not exactly a very a godly name. Because Jacob, the first Jacob in the Bible, he was a deceiver, but later on God changed his name to Israel. Is Israel a good name, Pastor Israel? Yeah. Because Israel means Prince of God. So, you know, hallelujah. He's not Pastor Deceiver sitting over there, okay? He's Pastor Prince of God, okay? It's a good name. God changed his name. But why was his name Jacob to begin with? Because that's what his character was, his nature. He was a deceiver. He's always lying, okay? Well, same thing here. God is saying what his nature is. He's the healer. He is saying, in fact, the Hebrew words literally mean that it is my will to heal always. Okay? I say this very affirmatively because I know a lot of us doubt. A lot of us, we've seen cases, we maybe have been part of a healing prayer when we pray for somebody and that person did not get healed. So then Satan starts dropping these thoughts in our mind. Oh, see, it's not God's will. It's not always God's will. So don't ever say that it's God's will all the time, because maybe some instances when people get healed, it's God's will, but other times it's not God's will. Okay? You know, that's like saying that it's not God's will not to save sometimes. Okay? Is it ever God's will not to save somebody? It's always God's will. Now, does that mean that everyone will always get saved? Like next week when we bring our church friend, will everybody get saved just because it's God's will to save everybody? No, because there's other factors. There's your own human will, right? If you don't want to get saved, even though it's God's will to save you, you don't get saved because you don't want to get saved. You know, there are people, believe it or not, people come up for a healing line and they really don't want to get healed. Some come up testing God. There's been people, I have prayed for people who are demonized. You know, there's a demon in them. I pray to cast out the demon, and they come up in the line, and yet they don't get the demon cast out. Why? Because the demon is their friend. It's the only friend they have. They're still holding on to it. See, there's somebody's will still involved here. So we can't just conclude, oh, because the person can get healed, then I guess it's not God's will. Same thing with the salvation. You know, some people don't get saved because they're still working out. Maybe the devil is brainwashing them. See, the Bible says that, well, I just preached on this. The devil comes like an angel of light. He makes the world look so good. And he says, what do you need God for? What do you need church for? What do you need the Bible for? Look at everything I offer is much better. And you can sin and no problem. You don't have to repent. You can just enjoy your sins. And I give you all these other things that God gives you. So he says, right? And that's why some people don't get saved either. The devil, you see? There's a lot of reasons why people may not get saved, but it's not God's fault. And it doesn't say that God, it's not God's will to save people. Amen? You following? It's the same thing. He is Jehovah Rapha. He is the Lord that heals. It is his will to heal all the time. But we have to understand that there may be some situation that's not out of God's hands. What? I thought that nothing is impossible. Didn't we just sing about that? Yeah, but at the same time, he doesn't inflict his will on somebody else. See, if you decide that you're not going to want to worship him, he's not going to make you worship him. If you decide that you don't want to get saved, he's not going to make you be saved. If you don't want to get healed, he won't force healing on you. You see, there's a will, and the devil has this pretty strong will too. And some of us, we side with the devil. And when we side with the devil, his will becomes our will. See, that's the tricky thing about the devil sometimes. Is that you're so consumed in the devil's world that his will for you not to be healed is causing you not to be healed. No. I'm trying to preach some Bible here because I want this morning the truth to set you free. I want you to hear it. It is always God's will to heal. Okay? And we can get more into it. I can get really theological if you want, but not in this morning. Okay? Another time. But here, it is the Lord's will. And the centurion recognized that. He didn't ask, oh, well, by the way, you're the one that maybe heals, you know, on Sunday mornings. And so when church comes around, can I come then? And that's when you get, no, now, anytime. Because he always wants his will is to heal. Then the centurion, it says that in verse 8 is he starts explaining something. You know, Lord, I'm not worthy that you should come to my roof. I mean, I know I'm a leader. I have all these soldiers under me. I just speak a word and there it is. But I just don't feel worthy for you. You know, and here's the thing, okay? This person who has authority, who can send others to do his work, he is basically saying to Jesus, you know, I'm not going to force my way on you, even though I know a lot of things. Even though because as a centurion, I tell my soldiers what to do. I'm used to doing that. I'm used to telling people what to do because they're seeking leadership and they listen to me. But I know with you, I can't tell you what to do. So you do what you want to do. You do it your way. And that's a problem that a lot of Christians have. We want God to bless us, but we want God to bless us our way. Huh? Yeah. Like, Lord, here's my prayer request. But, you know, if you don't answer it in like 10 seconds, then I'm not going to believe that it's your will. Right? We make it his way. Right? Or, you know, I know some young adults here. God, here's my list of my mate. It's got to be this list. Or else forget it. Not your will. You know, it's my will. You know? Man, do you know this woman met very few things in my list? When I met her, that's why I wasn't interested in her. And she certainly wasn't interested in me either. We you know, there's a few things that are really important, but some of the other things, you know, I don't want to get into it right now because it's not a dating seminar and all that stuff, okay? Ask me another time, okay? But the thing is, if I had not listened to God and listened to my own way, wanting to do it my way, I would have missed out on the greatest woman in my life. And some of us, we're trying to put God in a box and we're missing God's best for our lives. I'm not kidding. Right? Especially those who have been Christian for a long time. If you kind of, you know, got kind of, you know, too much into theology, not that that's bad, but you learned it a certain way and you've got this certain way of thinking and God, if you don't do it this way, then I guess it's not your way. You know? No. This centurion learned from him. He's used to barking out orders, doing things his way, that whole army would do it his way, but yet he recognized, Jesus, with you, I'm going to do it your way. Because maybe my way, compared to your way, is not so good. And we need to look, when we say that Jesus is Lord, we got to give him complete lordship. It means that, Lord, your way, your will, not my will. Let your will be done. See, when he did that, oh man, that was huge. That's when Jesus says, wow, never, not even anywhere in Israel, have I found such great faith, it says in verse 10. Great faith. See what was going on here. Okay? See, great faith means that you're going to trust him no matter what. I know some of us, we carved out a certain way of how things are supposed to happen. But no, Lord, if you don't do it this way, you know, like how it works, we're going to pray for the sick later. Some of you have already determined, if you don't get healed in service, then you're gonna stop praying. You're gonna conclude, well, I guess it's not God's will, and his grace is sufficient for me. And so with his grace, I'm just gonna bear with this pain for another week or two until he decides that he will heal me. See, already, you're already telling him how to do it. He may want to do it his way. And in fact, what's really important here is that because the centurion was willing to let God do it his way, it says, Jesus says in verse 13, go your way, and as you have believed, so it be done for you. And his servant was healed that same hour. This is the reason why I wanted to read this translation. Because other translations said that moment, which is a wrong translation. The word is not moment in the Greek. The moment is an actual word, hour. What is that saying? is that sometimes he doesn't heal you instantly. If you've got this time frame that you're putting on the Lord, and you're saying that if you don't heal me in 5 minutes, then forget it. I guess it's not your will. You just missed out if you just hang on for another 55 minutes. What's another 55? You've been going through this pain for so long. What's a little longer? Is it giving up so easily? That's not being relentless. See, faith is holding on however long it takes. As a Christian, I told you, faith. It takes faith to be saved. A real Christian will hang on to the Lord as long as it takes. Even if the blessings don't come your way. Even if prayers don't get answered. Even when good relationships are even not there. You're going to hold on to the Lord no matter what. See, that's strong faith. That's great faith. And that's what's going on here. And because of that, his servant was healed that same hour. Not that same moment, not instantly. He still had to believe. His faith was still being exercised. And so, a little bit later, when we start praying, maybe you come up and you're in pain. And after the prayer, you're still in pain. And in fact, you could even be in more pain. Because the enemy wants to really mess you up. See why you can't go to God? Because when you go to God, and you see why you can't go to that prayer warrior? Because when you go to that prayer warrior, what's going to happen? You're going to double the pain. So stop praying about it. Then you'll never get your healing. See, understand, there's a spiritual battle going on. The devil has marked this day, this is a day that he's going to mess up some of you. He's going to make sure that some of you will leave this service with even more pain. You go, oh, what am I doing here? Let me get out of here now. No. Because we're learning about great faith. Great faith will fight the enemy. We're not going to let the enemy beat us around like that. If he is for us, who can be against us? Amen. We're going to believe with great faith that the miracle will come. If it takes an hour, so be it. If it takes a day, so be it. If it takes another week, so be it. Let's just hang on. In my spiritual leadership class, I just taught, Daniel hung on for 3 weeks before an answer came. 3 weeks. Some of us will give up after 1 day, 2 days, 20 days. We don't hang on for that extra day. Some of us don't hang on for that extra 5 minutes. You've done it for 55 minutes. The healing is coming in 5 more minutes, and you can't hang on. That's when the healing comes. That's great faith. I think about my Mission Sunday, some of the missionaries that we support. Heidi Baker. Oh, what a woman of God she is. And I think about those 20 blind people that she told me about, that she prayed for, didn't get healed. 20 people. And you think after 20, that's enough? Okay, let's move on to other kinds of sicknesses, because maybe that's not the gifting God has for me. Maybe it's not God's will to heal blindness. Those are some of the things that she could conclude. But instead, she dared to pray for a 21st blind person. And that's when that person got healed. And because she would not stop, because she believed in doing it God's way. See, if it's her way, then, okay, you know, my first time, maybe I kind of jumble my words around and all that, maybe, but the second or third person should be a healing. But no. 20! And here's a woman of God who has done great things for God, but she hung on because it's God's ways. And so she's going to trust God, and 21st got healed, and now 7 out of 10 people who she prays for gets, 7 out of 10 blind people who she prays for gets healed now. Because she determined that God's way is the best way. I think about Pastor Pam Seward, who was one of our missionaries in Nepal. And she was telling me the story of a baby who fell out of a second floor building. A baby hit the concrete, died. Of course, you would imagine that. But again, everybody else is planning the funeral. She's saying that, no, I think God has some resurrection power. And in their church in Nepal, they got a 45-minute understanding. Is that they'll pray for the dead for 45 minutes. If they don't wake up, then funeral time. So she took advantage of that 45 minutes, and they rushed the baby, of course, to the hospital, right? But during that 45 minutes, the baby woke up. And she told me just recently, that baby is no longer a baby. Actually, the baby is now a youth now, still alive. You know, with nothing, no broken bone, nothing, because God's resurrection power. But God did it his way. And she allowed. Amen. Give the Lord a clap offering for that. You see, God can do the impossible. What a great song, Pastor Del Rey. See, and we have to understand, maybe healing might be gradual. Some may be instantaneously. You know, a little bit later, I believe that there's going to be some people going to get healed instantly. That's God's way for that moment, for that person, for that situation. But maybe for somebody else it's not. We have to understand God is God's variety. Even in the Bible, Jesus, there's so many different ways of healing. So many different results. And the thing is, are we going to be like the centurion and say, hey, I'm not going to be the boss here. You be the boss. Because some of us are too bossy. Some of us need to let God be the boss. Amen. Instead of just trying to command our own lives and all that. That's not being a Christian. Being a Christian means he's the Lord. Please turn with me to also to Matthew 15. See the second story here. Is some faith rising up in the house now? Amen. Because again, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. If you're hearing the word, the faith is rising up. And we need faith if healing is going to take place. Matthew 15, starting from verse 21. Leaving that place, Jesus withdrew to the region of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, Lord, son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly. Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, send her away, for she keeps crying out after us. He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel. The woman came and knelt before him. Lord, help me, she said. He replied, it's not right to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs. Yes, it is, Lord, she said. Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. Then Jesus said to her, woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted. And her daughter was healed that moment. Now we have somebody who is definitely not a Christian. Somebody who is not a believer at this moment. And she comes to Jesus because her daughter is sick and possessed or demonized. And but she, again, believed that Jesus can heal because she believes that God can heal always. Okay? So she goes, but it doesn't seem like she's worthy because she's not a Christian. But here's a lesson here, okay? Now, I don't want to get into all the theology, why Jesus said it this way and all that stuff, okay? That's another sermon, and you know, but because it seems kind of, wow. You know, a woman comes to Jesus, can you help me? And he calls her a dog, right? Basically, right? And maybe not to make it sound so bad, actually in the Greek it's puppy, okay? So it's not so bad, okay? But still, what is she saying is that you actually don't deserve healing. And if Jesus wanted to at this moment, he could have said, every person on earth doesn't deserve healing. In fact, you may be a puppy, but there's some old dogs out there. And they don't deserve, nobody deserves that, in fact. But because of his grace and mercy, he can be moved because of his grace and mercy. How? The lesson in this story, because this woman would not give up. This woman was relentless. She never said, I'm not a dog. I'm not a puppy. Why do you call me an animal? She didn't disagree with it. She, in fact, accepted it and said, yeah, yes, it is. See, basically, she said, I am dog, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. In other words, that even in some humble way, if I can just get something from you, I may not get the full blessing of maybe people who deserve more, but if I can just get something from you, I know I don't even deserve it. Those people get a lot of blessings. They don't deserve it too because we're all dogs in this world, really. But by your grace and mercy, because I don't want to stop. I don't want to quit. It's not about me. It's about my daughter. And I'm loving my daughter as myself right now. That's a second commandment. I don't want to leave here until I get something from you, Lord. I want to hold on to you. And if you make me beg, I will beg. If you want me to wait, I will wait. If you want me to pray and fast, I will pray and fast. I will do whatever you tell me to do, but don't send me away. You can call me a dog. You can call me a gorilla. You can call me whatever. But I'm not going to let go of you. That's what this story is all about. Being relentless. Not to let go. Because you know that the blessing is right there. Because you know that the Lord is his will to heal always. And when we come at the altar. And we want something from the Lord. We're going to determine that we're going to get it. Now I'm not saying that, you know, we're going to come up here and, Lord, I'm just so full of sin. And I love my sinful habit. I'm not going to give any of that up. And now bless me. Okay, you can fight all you want. You're going to lose that fight. Okay? You got to humble yourself. You got to say that, Lord, whatever you want me to give up, I will give up just so that I can get something from you. Okay? I want to make sure I make that clear right now. But because she was willing to be relentless, then Jesus' reply was, woman, you have great faith. These are the two stories in the English Bible that talk about great faith. And they both pertain to people who aren't even Christians. So if non-Christians
can get great faith because it's a spirit that gives it. That's what it says in 1 Corinthians 12:9. It's a spirit that gives great faith. How much more to those that worship him? How much more to those who really trust in him and have been trusting him? How much more to those who have been in prayers and fasting and really have given their lives to the Lord? How much more great faith can come their way? But some of us, the problem is that the great faith that's given, you're not relentless about it. You give up too easily. You don't wait it out. You don't trust him. You don't just hold on and say, Lord, until you bless me, I'm not going to let go. Don't let go. Don't quit. Hang on. Jesus saw her relentless faith and hallelujah, the miracle came.
Last year, I was preaching in a mega church. And it was a missions conference. And one night, I just felt, I preached, I think, five nights. And on one of the nights, it was the focus was on the young adults. And so it was a young adult service. And the pastor, what he did was that for the missions conference, it's a different format from ours. But for that particular night, it was the focus on young adults. And they can invite pre-believers, too. Okay, a missions conference. Invite, why not missions? You know, it's all about saving the lost. So why not have them come to our missions conference, too? Okay, that was how the pastor did it. And I remember that night, I just felt led to pray for the sick, even though I was supposed to preach. And I did preach, but afterwards, because a young adult, they like to hang out late. Any of our young adults like to hang out late? Yeah, a lot of you guys, right? Well, that's the nature, right? You know, you get the older people, parents, and all, got to rush home, right? But young adults, right, you know, just hang out, right? But it was okay. The pastor gave me permission to pray for the sick, and anybody had to leave early, they can leave early, but, you know, all of them just hung around. And I remember, you know, when I start praying for the sick, okay, I was praying for, of course, you know, one of the anointings that God's given to me is to lengthen legs, and I started praying for legs. They're growing out, and I got all these iPhones going, oh, look at that. And it was on so many people's Facebook posting that night, you know. But the thing is, the pastor had asked one of his workers to tend to the book table because they were selling Missions Power, my book. And so after the prayer and all that, I went to the back because there were actually a line of people who had already bought the book and they wanted me to sign the book. So I went there and I was signing, and the worker, she was just working really hard, and then there was a break. Okay, nobody in the line, nobody was coming to the book table. And then she said, oh, I saw all those healings on the stage. I said, yeah. I've been waiting for this day. I've been, you know, I'm telling you, the devil has told me that God doesn't love me. Because, you see, I've had scoliosis for many years. And I've gone to the doctors. I've gone to different people for prayer. And I have not been healed. But I got excited, especially when all the iPhones came out. And, like, God's getting glorified. I want God to be glorified in my body. Do you think that would be possible? And I said, yeah, you've been helping me. At least, I mean, because the healing service is over. I said, no, healing happens. God, he wants to heal always, even right now. He said, like, right here at the book table? I said, sure, but it's not the sanctuary. Doesn't matter. God's everywhere. So you want to do it right now? She says, like, right now? I said, yeah, but nobody's buying books right now. Let's do it right now. And so she pulled up her skirt, her left leg was all mangled. You know, if you can imagine with me, okay? I'm going, oh boy, this is a biggie, okay? I'm not used to a mangled leg like that. But I just saw her faith. She wanted to be healed so badly. She just saw God healing other people. And I could just see that faith. I mean, I think she had more faith than I did at that moment. Because she said, I believe the leg's coming out. The leg's coming out because I saw them making it come out too. I said, okay, let's believe together. And this is the first time it's ever happened to me. When I held up the legs, because I normally, it's legs that don't look deformed. But this leg was definitely deformed. And within seconds, it came out. Straightened out. And that thing, amen. Give the Lord, the Lord. Not me, the Lord. Because I honestly believe it was more her faith than my faith. But see, that great faith that the Holy Spirit gave her that very moment, that's the kind of faith that God wants to give us.
And some of us have been waiting for some time. Some of us have been suffering for some time. Some of us have been in pain for some time. But are we going to let the Lord be the boss? Are we going to let him do it his way? Because if so, if we're going to be relentless and say, God, I have great faith in a great God. And it's not in a man. It's not me or anybody else who's praying. It's about the one who does the healing. Because in this church, there's only one healer in this church. And that's his name is Jesus Christ. Everybody else is an instrument. Everybody. When on Tuesday, I said, I'm just a receptionist. Yeah. You know? Or sometimes I'm the registered nurse. Donna. Yeah. I'm just like you. You know, somebody is sick. I just bring you to the real doctor. Because I'm not the doctor. I don't have an MD next to my name. I'm just Mr. Christian. That's all. And as a nurse, right? Nurses don't heal, right? Have you ever healed? No. Of course not, right? That's why you're a nurse, okay? The nurse takes the patient to the doctor and let the doctor do his thing. Well, the doctor in this house is Jesus Christ. So none of us should say that we're the doctors. Only one doctor. So let's be the receptionist that invite people. Hey, God's going to do something good here. Let's be the nurse that says, let me take you to Jesus. Hallelujah. And let Jesus be the one that does the healing. Heavenly Father, thank you for your words this morning. Hallelujah. Because, Lord, you still heal. You're the same today, yesterday, today, and forever. You were the healer back then. You're the healer today. Lord, you heal people that I've seen, that I prayed for. I believe you're going to heal people today. And being Mission Sunday, Lord, I believe that you have a special heart to heal for the nations, oh God. For the people that need to be set free. Lord, for those who may not know you as Lord and Savior in this house. They may have been coming to church for some time. But Lord, they've been waiting for the evidence, the confirmation to know that you are Lord. May today be the day. And for those of us who have been witnessing, oh God, to our friends, our unchurched friends. But Lord, we just kind of lack the passion, the conviction to tell them about you. Lord, may today strengthen their faith. So that, Lord, they will be unashamed of the gospel of Christ. And that can result in them even bringing a friend to Friend Day next week, oh God. Heavenly Father, we pray that you will move like a mighty rushing wind. Because, Lord, your name is Jehovah Rapha. You are the Lord that heals, Lord. Not the Lord that used to heal, the Lord that heals now. And so, Lord, we ask that you just take over, Lord. Not the way we want it done. We're going to do it a certain way, but you have full freedom to do whatever you want to do, Lord. If you want to heal a different way, another methodology, you want to do a different timing, it's up to you. But Lord, we're just going to be obedient to your word that we're going to pray for healing right now because there are people who are in pain, who are sick, have disease, oh Lord. And Lord, right now, I believe your will is that they be healed. So Lord, let the healing God, Jehovah Rapha, move right now because by your son's stripes, we are healed in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask Amy, Catherine, and Pastor Israel to come up, and they're going to assist me with the healing right now because some of you are sick, some of you are in pain, and we're going to ask that if that's the case, that you be prepared to be prayed over. Okay, hallelujah. But for those who have maybe some back pain, okay. May I ask that you would sit in the front here, okay? We're just going to line you up here, okay? Those who have pain, so just kind of move aside. Those who have pain in the backs. Oh, you do? Oh, yeah. Okay, people who have pains in their back, if you could just sit here, okay? Anybody else? Two people? Only two people who have back pain? Okay, that's fine. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to pray for them. Meanwhile, if there's some other disease, if there's some kind of sickness, if there's an injury, you know, the Lord wants to heal injuries as well, okay? He does a pretty good job of that because he's the one that created your body. He can recreate it. Bone cracks, all that stuff, okay? I met this one preacher from South America. Prayed for somebody who had no teeth, came back up, full set of teeth. Why not? He's God. He made it to begin with. He made it just like that. He can remake it just like that too. See, some of us, our faith is not there. That's why, Lord, give us great faith this moment. Okay? So those who are need healing of some kind, okay, just come up and let them know what it is, and they're going to start praying. I'm going to pray for these two here. Okay? So Caroline, can you come up here? They're going to pray for you first. Okay? Hey, those, you can just come around here. What do you sit here? If you have back pain,
okay? It may be because maybe it might be because one leg is shorter than the other, okay? Because if one leg is shorter than the other, then you're limping, okay? And by limping, then it's causing undue back pain, right? And so what we want to do, if that's the case, is that we want to pray that the shorter leg will grow out, okay? And then that will fix the pain too. If it's not it, I'll just pray for your back anyways, okay? Is that good? Okay, so I'm going to ask you to just sit back, okay? I'm going to lift up your legs here, both legs. Oh, yeah, see, look at that. You see that? Okay, you see that this leg is an inch and a half longer than this leg. You see that? So what we want to do is we want to pray that this left leg will grow out, okay, to be the same length. So right now, Jesus gets growed out. You can see it right now. See, it's coming out right now. You see that? See, it's coming out already. Can you feel it? You can feel it? See, right there. See, it's the same length right now. See, right now. Hallelujah. See, the Lord just lengthened your leg just because I prayed over it. Is God good? Amen. Has this ever happened to you before? Amen. Can you stand up? Let me pray for your back as well. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord, for bringing Caroline to our church, oh God. Lord, just a few weeks ago, Lord, a pastor told her that this is the church she needs to come to, and now this is one reason, Lord, so that she can be healed. Thank you, Lord, for lengthening her left leg. Thank you, Lord, for healing her back right now. Take away all the pain right now from the crown of her head to the soles of her feet, oh God. Let her be made whole and strengthen her faith, Lord. Let her know that, Lord, you love her. You are interested in her life. You want to be the Lord of her life. And thank you, Lord, for touching her now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Are you excited?
Yes. Amen. Hallelujah.
No, okay. But it's mostly my neck. Okay, but we'll find out. Okay. All right, let's see, Pat. Let the legs here. Okay. No, they're the same length. Okay, so let's just pray for neck then, okay? Okay, stand up. Okay. Heavenly Father, we just want to pray right now for this back, oh God. This back. This neck, this spine right now. Lord, I pray for your healing virtue, oh God. You already did a healing just a few seconds ago. You're doing healings, Lord, among those who are at the altar. And right now, Lord, we just pray for your healing touch upon this back in Jesus' name, oh God. Lord, there's been so much pain, oh God. But right now, we pray that your healing virtue will come, Lord, and come upon this back, oh God. Be made whole. Be made whole because by your stripes, oh Lord, she is healed. This back is healed, Lord. The nervous system right now is getting healed right now because of your hand upon her, Lord. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Are you feeling anything?
Yeah, warmth.
You felt warmth? I felt a warmth.
A warmth.
You're feeling a warmth right now?
I feel a warmth going through my back.
Right now? Okay, want to feel more warmth? Okay.
Yes.
Lord, continue this warmth right now, this heat, oh God, this Holy Spirit heat, the fire of the Holy Spirit going down this spine right now, the back, oh Lord, in Jesus' name, hallelujah, Lord, you're doing the healing right now, Lord, complete the healing right now, Lord, as we're praying for this back, as we're praying for this spine, oh God, in Jesus' name, let it be your power, oh God, let it be your heat, let it be the Holy Spirit fire that is healing now, we pray in Jesus' name, amen, amen, hallelujah, you feeling it?
It's real warm right here.
Oh, praise God. Right there. Yeah. Huh? One more time?
Let's go for it.
Lord, we want complete healing right now, yes. Lord. So let the heat of the Holy Spirit, the fire, Lord, that can consume, the fire, Lord, that can ignite us, oh God, right now in Jesus' name, oh Lord. Take all the pain away, the discomfort, Lord. Do a correction to the spine right now, the neck area, Lord. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah.
Well, my headache's gone.
Your headache's gone?
My headache is gone.
Amen. Give the Lord praise. Hallelujah. Thank God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God is good. God is good. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Play some background music, okay? Let's just be worshiping the Lord. You see what God's already doing right now? See? Some's going to be instantaneous. Some's going to be gradual. But it's God. And by the way, Kat is not a healer. Amy's not a healer. Pastor Israel's not a healer. I'm not a healer. Okay, we're just the registered nurses, Donna, that's bringing the patients to Jesus. And we're letting Jesus do it. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me pray for some people here. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
just join in. You know, if you're not sick, we don't want you to be bored, okay? Because it's not your time. You're not in pain or whatever, okay? If you're in pain, of course, you'll be up here, and you want the Lord to heal you, okay? But those who are saying that I'm fine and all that, don't just sit there. Add to the prayers, okay? Be in prayer. Let's be praying for our brothers and sisters who are in pain, because one day you're going to be in pain too, and you'll wish that they prayed for you while you were in your state, okay? So be in prayer as all the different people are being prayed over. Hallelujah. Okay, our brother, he was in an accident, right? Accident. And because of that, this left leg, he told me, is shorter than the right leg. He knew it. And so we're going to pray that Jesus is going to heal that, right? You believe that? Did you see what happened to the other ones? Yeah, you think that Jesus can do that for you too? Amen. Hallelujah. Okay. Lord, right now, in Jesus' name, in your name,
grow it out. Grow it out right now. That's it. That's it. Just grow it out right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Did you feel that? Did you see it grow out like that? Hallelujah. And now, Lord, bring complete healing to his heel right now, Lord, even as you have restored his left leg. And, Lord, I just pray, Lord, that there's been a demon on him. And so right now, we come against this demon in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Demon, I don't know your name, but I command you to stop oppressing my brother. I command you to stop harassing him in the name of Jesus. He doesn't need you. All he needs is the Lord. So right now, I command you to leave him alone. And Lord, I just pray for a hedge of the Holy Spirit to surround him so that, Lord, you would protect him, oh God. You would quench all the fiery darts of the enemy and that, Lord, he can live solely and wholly for you. Thank you for touching his leg. Thank you for touching his body. And now thank you for touching his soul. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. You feel awesome? Let's hear that. Okay.
How do you feel?
I feel awesome.
Tell me what difference you feel.
I literally seen it grow out, and I feel more stable.
Feel more stable because he said that his heel was actually shattered. Hallelujah. Praise God. What's your name?
Shane.
All right. Man, Shane, God's got an eye on you. Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. Okay, we need some extra faith here, okay? I'm going to ask our sister to just face you, okay? Pastor Vicky, come up here, okay? We're going to combine our faith, okay? The Bible talks about prayer of agreement. Sometimes one person's faith is not enough. We need more than just one person praying a prayer of faith. We need to have a collection of people praying a prayer of agreement. Our sister here has colon cancer, okay? Now, that's serious. It's obviously life-threatening, okay? But again, what may seem impossible to man is totally possible with God, okay? So I ask that we all pray for our sister right now. Pastor Vicky, I'm going to ask you that you lead. I already prayed for her. I'm going to ask that you pray, and Wai Ming will translate, okay, so that she understands your prayer, okay? Let's join our faith together right now.
Heavenly Father, I know that you do miracles. And Father, I've seen this woman do miraculous things. But Father, we pray for cancer to be removed from her body. Every cancerous cell, let it be gone in this body. Specifically in her colon, her intestines, Lord, remove the cancer. Every infection, be gone in Jesus' name. Replenish healthy cells in every part of her intestines. Give her strength, Lord, that is supernatural because of the hand of God. And I pray for every virus, every infection, every cancerous cell, flee from this body, never to return again. And healthy cells continue to build in her body. White blood cells, let that replenish to fight off any kind of infection. And help my sister have faith, great faith, to believe that you heal. Father, we love our sister, and I pray that you do a miracle for her again and again and again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. 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 See, sometimes God will use different people to pray for people. Sometimes he wants the church collectively to be praying. There will be teams and all that. But ultimately, because we're all just registered nurses, right? Just joining together, encourage one another so that the Lord, the doctor, can do the healing. Amen. Hallelujah. Anybody else? Anybody else? Hallelujah. God is so good. Thank you, Jesus. If there's anybody else that's in pain, just stand up, okay? If there's any kind of pain that you have, you don't want to come up here, but you just want to stand up, okay? We're going to pray one blanket prayer right now, okay? You're in pain, in some, you're uncomfortable, whatever, just stand up right now in Jesus' name. Okay, those who are standing up, those around them, can you go and lay hands on them right now, okay? Just go lay hands on them and believe that, again, you're the registered nurse leading that person to Jesus so that Dr. Jesus can heal that person in Jesus' name, okay? Begin praying right now. Begin praying. Pray to Jesus, the doctor, that he will heal those who are in pain right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pour out your healing, Lord. Pour it down right now in Jesus' name. Release it into every sick body, Lord. Heal the pain, Lord. Start healing the nervous system, so God. Oh, Lord, those people who are feeling the pain in their arms, so God. Heal the arms right now. Those who are feeling the leg pain, so God. Heal the legs, so God. The hips, so God. Heal that, the headache, so God, that they're feeling, oh God. Take away the headache, oh God. Let it shrink until it's nothing, oh God. Lord, the neck pain, so God. Take that away. The chest pains, Lord. The breathing problem, oh God. Lord, everything from the crown of their head to the soles of their feet, oh God. Heal them right now in Jesus' name because you are Dr. Jesus. Hallelujah. So do it, Lord. Do it right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You are Dr. Jesus. You are Jehovah Rapha. Hallelujah. And we thank you, God. We're thanking you, oh God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We bless you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. Okay. You know, the Bible says in Revelation 12:11 that they will defeat the devil by the word of their testimony. Okay? Those that felt a healing this morning, raise your hand like this. Just wave it. Okay? Tell the devil, I'm healed now. I'm receiving healing from the Lord. Look at the hands. Hallelujah. You see that? Okay? That's instantaneous healing. Hallelujah. Those that receive something from the Lord already. You see how good God is? Wow. Look at all the hands that are just raised. See, the devil doesn't like that. He meant for this service to somehow mix you up, mess you up and all that. The truth shall set you free. Amen? The truth will set you free. Hallelujah. Would you bow your heads with me? Would you bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, I pray for one last move of the Holy Spirit right now. Lord, what just happened took faith, great faith. Because some of this stuff that just happened, the doctors could not have done it. That's why it takes great faith. But Lord, there's another faith that I talked about. It's a faith for salvation. And I pray, oh God, that the Lord, those that don't know you as Lord and Savior, right now, Lord, let faith rise up so that they will accept you as the Lord and Savior of their lives. With your head still bowed, eyes closed, how many of you have never made a decision to accept Jesus? I mean, I'm not talking about you, this is your first time in church. I'm not talking about that. You could have been coming to church. You could have read the Bible. Your parents could have been Christians. But you personally never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And today is the day because today God just showed up. God just showed up and said that he's interested in your life. He loves you. He wants to be a part of your life. If that's you and you've never accepted Jesus before, I want you to raise your hand because we want to pray with you. Yes, I see that hand. Anybody else? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. You never accepted Jesus before? You never accepted Jesus before? You did? Okay, that's okay. Okay. Okay, I'm going to ask Caroline, would you come up? You have your hand raised, right? Hallelujah. I want, amen. Many of you know that Pastor Vicky and I were the first two volunteers at City Impact 3 decades ago. Okay, Pastor Roger talks about it. Okay, well, the third person to volunteer, his name is Pastor Kenny Rogers, not the singer. Okay, and we became really good friends because he used to do the worship leading at City Impact. And I have preached in his church many times. He's preached for me. This is when I used to live in San Francisco. Well, Caroline lives here in Hawaii, but she was in the Bay Area a few weeks ago. And she walked into my friend, Pastor Kenny Rogers' church. And then the conversation continued where she asked, she says, I live in Hawaii. I've been messing around Mormonism, all that stuff. But I want to find a good Christian church.
and Pastor Roger got me on FaceTime. Seriously, talking about high tech here, okay? Got me on FaceTime, and I talked with her on FaceTime with my iPhone, and I invited her to come here. Her first Sunday was Missions Conference Sunday. And she's been coming a few Sundays now, and today is your day to have Jesus write your name in his Amen. Book of life. Amen. To say that you are a Christian, you're a daughter of God, you're going to heaven. Amen? Vicky, would you lay your hands upon her right now? Hallelujah. Let's pray this prayer together. Okay, we're going to, Caroline, we're going to pray a prayer together. Can you repeat after me? And everybody else is going to pray this because we're supporting what you are doing as a new Christian, okay? Heavenly Father. Thank you for your love.
Thank you for your love.
Thank you for Jesus.
He died for me.
And he's saving me now. I accept him. As my Lord.
As my Savior.
Make me a Christian.
Make me a daughter of God.
Write my name.
In the book of life.
So that when I die.
I will go to heaven.
Thank you for your blessings.
Thank you for your blessings.
Thank you for loving me.
Thank you for loving me.
I love you too.
I love you too.
In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Lord, I thank you for Caroline right now. And Lord, I pray that she is now your daughter. Lord, you blessed her by bringing her to this church. Then you blessed her, oh God, by healing her leg. And now you blessed her because now you just accepted her as a child of God. She is going to heaven. She's not going to some Mormon made up place, oh God. She is going to heaven. And Lord, we just pray that, Lord, your hand be upon her, protect her from the enemy, and let us as a church, Lord, just get around her and help her walk in her new walk now as a daughter of yours. And we pray for your blessings upon her. Answer her prayers, oh God. Lead her, guide her, bless her. We pray this in Jesus' name. And everybody said, Amen. Give the Lord another clap offering. Hallelujah. Stand up with me. Stand up with me. Hallelujah. You know what? Healings are great. And Pastor Deshaun, when he was here a few years ago, and he's going to be again here next year when he speaks at Missions Conference, he said, healings are great, but you can be healed physically, but if you're not healed in here, when you die, you're still going to hell. So what good is healing unless you get healed in here? This morning, Caroline just got healed in here. Hallelujah. She got healed with a leg, and she got healed in the heart. Hallelujah. You know what? I want us to get excited about next week's Friend Day. You see, God is in the saving business. He's in the healing business. He's in every good business. Hallelujah. And so let's get our friends out. We believe that God can do something special in your unchurched friends next week. Hallelujah. Lord, just want to thank you for what you did today. You are a good God, Lord. And thank you, Lord. It is your will to heal always. Hallelujah. And it's also your will to save always, oh God. So thank you for healing people. Thank you for saving people, oh God. You are such an awesome God, and we give you the honor and glory. Now, be with us as we go our separate ways. And Lord, let us work on bringing some unchurched friend, because Lord, we want more than just Caroline getting saved. We want our unchurched friends getting saved too, oh God. So Lord, we pray for the blessing, all the plans, oh God, especially upon Juliana, who's spearheading a lot of the logistics, oh God. Give her strength, give her ideas, surround her with a good team, oh God. And next week, Lord, when we come back here, oh God, with our unchurched friends, Lord, you pour out your spirits, Lord, so that, Lord, people respond to a powerful message, oh God. We thank you, Lord. We give you the honor and glory. May you look good always. In Jesus' name we pray. And everybody said, Amen. Hallelujah.